this start on time?
Yes.
Yes. So, my name is Ahmet Erbulak, and you are in the mosque in North Windham, or Islamic Center of the Romantic. Please let me know if you cannot hear me, or want me to repeat it. Since English is my third language, so I may have some difficulty. So around 2 or 3 years ago, we are blessed with this location. We started in Willimantic, then moved here just for the local Muslims to practice. It is mostly active one day a week, which is Friday. However, we do pray 5 times a day, and and that 5 times a congregation prayer together. Usually, if you go any Muslim majority country, you see people praying 5 times a day in their mosques. One before the sunrise, one before sunrise called Fajr. The second one is noon time, afternoon, evening, and this is right after sunset, this is evening. And this is the weekly prayer, which is a Friday prayer. So I just want to give some overview. Today is and then here we pray in the morning and the evening also. what else? Anything else? And we are very small here, maybe 20 to 40 people, depends on the week. For the morning and the evening prayers, sometimes 3, sometimes 4. So this is a very new establishment. If you go to bigger cities, Hartford, they have more people attending, I see. And this is a lifelong journey. It's not a couple weeks, months. I remember my grandfather, he used to pray 5 times a day at the mosque, and he used to walk all the time. So you pretty much dedicate your time for this. This is a huge dedication. Muslim literally means those who submit, those who dedicate himself. So it's a quite experience actually. If you look at it. So today's topic is Islamic scripture, which is Quran. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. Then we can I can give you some historical information. So I was born in Turkey, and I grew up in a somewhat conservative family. However, I was quite cultural Muslim up until I get a chance to read the translation of this book. Interestingly, before I read the translation, I was already memorized maybe 40, 50 pages. So the way how it works, so over 85% of the Muslims are non-Arab, meaning they don't understand the language of their holy book. And this book is used in the prayer also. So most of them don't know what is being recited or what they are reciting. I think this is a big challenge for us. So even though I was, I memorized it, I didn't know the meaning. We were reading every day. This book is very interesting. Even the reading, it makes you feel really good. So when I came to the United States by myself, I had more time, more free time. So I sit down, I start reading it, and I was a bit shocked. I wasn't expecting, so it was a different, I was expecting something different, probably. so So I started asking questions to my friends, scholars, imams, and he said, "Oh, you're asking different questions. You never asked these questions before. What's going on?" So I told him, I started reading the book. So ever since, it's a journey for me, and I spent 2 years intense reading, so many times researching. So after the Quran, also I read the Bible cover to cover. I especially like the Torah part, the Old Testament. I just want to dedicate myself, and I start writing what came to my mind was what I am being inspired. So hopefully, if they ask me what do you want to do before you die, I'd like to publish before I die so I can leave something. So this is I have something. So I have a goal. So I hope God will bless me. And so we Quran is not a personal believed to be a revelation from God. So it came to the Arabs in the language of Arabic. So Arabs and Jewish people are cousins. One of them come from the family of Ishmael, the other one come from the Isaac, and both of them, they have the same father, and their language is quite similar, not same, same family, but not it's quite close. So after 600 years after Jesus, God wanted to connect with humans one more time through his revelation. So revelation is different than inspiration. Anybody can inspire by God. So revelation is a direct connection. So how it works is God send his angel with a message to the person. So in this case we have Muhammad, a person who's illiterate, who never give a public speech, and up until age of 40, he was a shepherd, he was doing some trades, just a regular guy. And he was not expecting this also. This is one of the verses in the book. He wasn't expecting this. In fact, when the verses came down, first series of verses came down, he kind of wanted to suicide, according to the one narration, because he couldn't handle. He was just a regular average Joe. Then out of he saw the angel, something happened, and this revelation took 23 years. This book, and this is an oral revelation, not a written. Nobody write it while his life. Some pieces being written, but not completely. So as soon as the verse came down, he just passed it along without edit, without modification, and everybody memorized it around him, whoever can handle this. And someone recently told me, it's really hard to keep your thoughts straight for 23 years. and after he told me
23 minutes.
So I didn't notice this before, but after he said it, I said, yes, that's quite actually right. So this book is quite interesting. There's a harmony in it. If you read it through, and the way it came down, not like the way it is being compiled today. So usually books are categorized by subject, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, or by size. You have the largest part, and then the middle part, or the small. And Quran is neither of them. So the way it is, the first verses came down, which is chapter 96, that we can open and read together. Just chapter 96. You can pretty much pick up any interpretation, but we are going to read from the blue book here. Let me see what is, yes. Page 642. So, how do we have 642. Let me read the Arabic version so you get understand how it is being read in Arabic. Everybody get it? 642. Recite in the name of your Lord who created. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Iqra bismi rabbikal ladhi khalaq. Khalaqal insana min 'alaq. Iqra wa rabbukal akram. الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. So this is the first five verses came down. Translation is: recite in the name of your Lord who created. So according to the narration, when this first came, he was in the cave. So at the age of 40, he started to be alone. He wanted to be secluded, far from the society. He wanted to listen himself days, months, and one night, angel Jibreel appeared to him, came with this verse, said, "Read, recite." And his reply was, "I don't know how to read, how to recite." And as you can see, we don't have his answer here. We only have the verse. So his dialogue is not being written in the book. And he continued to recite the verses. Created man from a clinging substance. Recite, and your Lord is the most generous, who taught by the pen, taught man that which he knew not. This is also quite interesting. Pen is being mentioned. So we are talking about 1400 years ago. Only few people know how to read and write in the whole city. And pen is you hardly see in the daily life, because it is very few who knew write, so it's not being used as common. But most scholars say this is the indication for the science and knowledge pen represent. So when he came, first verses came down, he was quite shocked. He ran away to his house. He told his wife what happened, and his wife covered him, said, "You know, take some rest." So I am rephrasing some of the incidents, just I'm summarizing. So and nobody was expecting from him also. So we are talking about in a society where people worship to idols, it was so common. Mostly Jewish people in the city used to worship one God without any, you know, partnership, but most of the people, they were worshiping, you know, many gods. They were just pagans, mostly. So after the verse came down, and we have other verses. So another verse is somewhere around, somewhere in the book, somewhere, you know, 40 pages from others. But another verse came down somewhere, 50 verses. So the verse came down, and God said, put this verse between this and this. So, you know, put this verse in between these and this. So it was quite interesting during this process. So any questions so far?
So the surahs weren't even, each surah is not one revelation.
Absolutely.
A verse might be a revelation.
So verses, several verses, one verse sometimes, and most of the verses is being compiled, but some of the verses being said, you know, take it off, take, there was an order, is don't count this verses no more. But there was no editing. Whatever came down, he tell the people, that's it. The reason I underline this very much, because think about you are writing something without any edit, modification, any edit. It's quite impossible. You know, we always, I mean, I personally, you know, several edition, you know, reduction of this. So it is really interesting. And people study this. There are some statistics in the book. It's quite interesting. At the end, you find exact same number, men mentioned and women mentioned exact same numbers. And you have, I have the statistics, I will share some of the statistics. Any other question?
I just want to be sure that I've understood what you're telling us.
Yes.
That these verses were handed down, not necessarily, but one by one, but not necessarily in the order in which they are printed here.
Absolutely, exactly, yeah.
So the relationships among the various verses are open to discussion, or you're looking for them? Is that the way you comment? We comment continually on what we read in the Torah.
Right.
And you comment continually on the among other things, not only what is said, but the relationships.
Yes. So there is a multidimensional relationship. So this is a divine order. We say the way it's compiled is by order of God. Yes. But also there is a behind the scene. There is a sequence of verses came down. So there is another relationship. And some of the verses came down, something happened, people arguing over there. So how it is being came, the revelation. So when the revelation came, he kind of lost himself in a way, and he started sweating little. And when he came back, he said, these are the verses came down. And so many verses are correcting him. For instance, people, you know, he's living his life, there's a problem in society, they came to him, he said, okay, let's do this. And verse came down, she said, you know, this is not the best decision, this is a better. So warning him, correcting him, some of his friends didn't recite some of the verses because some of the verses harsh against him, like, why you do this? So, but Prophet told them, just recite all of them. There is a wisdom behind this. There is, you know, so everybody can learn. One of his wife tells, if he wrote this book, he would hide these verses, because, you know, he personally being really criticized.
But there's no discussion about the order.
Yes, there is no.
There is
no second. No, for the order, no. This is this version that you hold. There is one version in terms of order. All the Muslims have one version of this in terms of orders. There is no second alternative to this in the Arabic text and the order itself.
Was the Prophet literate? Was he able to write down these things?
No, he was illiterate. Yes, he was illiterate. He didn't know read and write. So he had wars, and during the wars they write an agreement, and he asked his people, like, can you read this? What is being written? This is being narrated in the book. We have several verses telling him you are illiterate. So one of the explanations to this, if he were a scholar, people would say, you know what, you just read the Torah, and you just came up with your own version. So he was illiterate, and nobody heard him speaking anything similar until age of 40. And especially during his time, Jewish people came to him and asked, like, what do you know about this? And his first answer was like, I really don't know. Then verse came down and he told the, this is chapter 12, for instance. This is one of them. He didn't know. And he wasn't hiding this. He said, I really don't know.
During the time of these revelations, did someone of his group write it down?
No, not really. It's not being written. So after 40 years after his death, first writing.
So can we be sure that in those 60 years that there were not some changes in what we think now is the revelation?
Right. So, even today, millions of people are memorizing this book. In fact, I have a documentary I can show you. Just a couple minutes. So back in the time, there were thousands of his friends did memorize it in a mass scale. Everybody memorized it. And this is being recited during the prayer. This is the only prayer book that you can recite in the prayer. So constantly this is being written, recited over and over again. The reason it is compiled 40 years after, during the expansion of Islamic land, some of the scholars start dying during the war. They said, you know what, let's write it down. So we have a several copy in all over the world that's the first written document. Let me show you that. So even today I know several people who memorize this book cover to cover. And it is still continuing a mess here. We have millions of Muslims memorizing this book. Almost all the imams memorizing this book, cover to cover. It's not like a couple pages. I'm a regular member. I know like 50 pages by heart, memorization. Because we are used this every day. Every day we're reciting this. But traditionally they start in the 4 years, 4 months, and 4 days. When the kids came 4 years, 4 months, and 4 days, they start the letting memorize. This is the tradition. Documenting 3 10 years old from 3 different continents, they are memorizing this.
Mm-hmm.
this is one of the
and girls are memorizing the
yes, girls, boys, and in the state of Connecticut, I know several places they are letting kids memorize this. So they have dedicated staff, they memorize every day around 10 pages. So it's within a year or so they completed memorization.
Wow.
How long is it? 10 years?
Around 1 year. Around 1 year, 2 years.
It's not, maybe it's easier in here, but like one of the things that I noticed trying to read through the Quran is how repetitive it is. And if I'm trying to learn a passage of Torah, it's the repetitive parts that are a little bit different each time that are the hardest to remember, because is it this one or is it that one, or is it, right?
You similar, know? Actually similar.
Yeah.
It is, as you said, there's so much repetition in the book, and but every time it is different in a way. So, but I don't know, somehow it's easy to memorize.
And what should we learn from this?
Well, I suspect it also has to do with, I mean, it a little bit rhymes in Arabic, right? I suspect the Arabic and the poetry of it.
It does.
Make it more memorable,
yes.
Than it.
Yes,
than
there is some. But still, it's a huge dedication.
Yeah.
The bigger dedication, not the memorize actually, is kept before without forgetting it, having keep at all your life.
Yeah.
So this is the hard part. So I know several people who recite 100 pages a day, so they can keep up with this.
I'm going to ask that question again. Sometimes in our faith we say, and we should learn from this, or you can learn from this. But in both of these faiths, there's a great deal of a great lack of precision here and there. There are places where there's precision, but there are many places where there are many questions and always nuance depending on the time and the questions that come up in that particular context. So I'm thinking to myself that in my thoughts are running this way, that there is no orthodoxy. There is no, it's only this way and no other.
Yeah.
So that we should, our minds, our hearts, should always be open to others.
Absolutely. So if you look at any interpretation of Quran, the most repeated verse is Allah A'lam, which means God knows best. They say the last sentence almost always is God knows best. You know, we came up with this much. This is not absolute truth. You know, you may come up something better. So absolutely, there is a room always.
Mm.
Can you repeat that in Arabic?
Wallahu
a'lam. What is that again?
Wallahu a'lam means
Allah.
God knows better or best.
Oh.
Yes. Wallahu
a'lam.
Yes. Yes, sir.
The way I look at it, the three religions share.
Can you shout?
That some people in each religion may believe it's absolute. They're very devout, religious people within each religion tend not to question as much, I think.
Of course, yes. Most people, either Jewish, Christian, or Muslim, are cultured. They are, because they happen to born in that location within that family. Very few people are questioning. That's very true. So this is our comfort zone. You know, very few people want to get out of their comfort zone and question. However, in the Quran, if you read it, you will find quite so many verses pushing you to question. Don't you think about this? Don't you, you know, why you don't ask questions? Why you don't ponder upon this? So it is pushing you to question the universe, the creation, to understand the wisdom behind this, not just, you know, imitate. So that it's supposed to be consciousness behind your faith.
It's the questioning that allows for change.
Yeah.
Over time.
Yes.
I just noticed here in the foreword it says it speaks with the perfect knowledge of the Creator about His creation. But then it says it exposes the truth and invites men to the way of truth. It doesn't say to truth, but
right.
To the way.
Yes.
Of truth.
So most of the verses is very similar. They don't tell you do's or don'ts. Instead, they call to either state of action. He says be truthful. Instead of saying, you know, say the truth, book says be truthful, be mindful, you know, be so it is the state of being that you have to be.
Okay,
yes.
Are there other verses you would like to share with us?
Yes. So I have maybe a little bit more time. So most of the, there's a general categorization of the book. One third of the book is about monotheism, being God is one. And I discussed this with the scholar in the Harvard Seminary a couple days ago. She's a Christian scholar. She said, no, the whole book about God, it's not one third. And which I agree, yes. But specifically, is God in this book is very, he's underlining about him being without a partner, without associating in a partner, very important to him. In fact, one of the unforgivable sin is associating him as a partnership. You know, telling him, you know, he has. So the reason we use Allah instead of God, Allah means one and only God without any partner. So it is very, very important in our life. And as a Muslims, almost every week, every month, we are asking each other, like, are you doing anything maybe hidden? Sometimes you say, you take aspirin, you say, I feel well right now because I took aspirin. Some scholars say, no, you shouldn't say this. Instead, you should say, God give you health through this.
Mm.
The source is God, not the aspirin. So, you know, they are very precise, trying to understand, you know, to give the credit to the God all the time.
In part with that, I'm believing or understanding that that helps keep from the multiple gods of which the Quran was created, in which there was a lot of
idolatry. Yes, during the society there was so many gods, you know, little gods. So they worship their idols. So they did believe God, but the God himself is in the book is one alone, without any beginning and without any end. No gender above the creation is the creator. So it is really, I really invite you to discover, you know, the way how he described himself, God, is quite interesting. I really like it, you know, all these verses.
I wanted to say one other thing about this no partner. There's a verse that really impressed me about this no partner and the notion of idolatry, you know, because you think, okay, well, none of us are bowing to statues or saying, okay, you know, this, whatever, this thing created the world or the sun or the moon, but there's a verse where it explicitly says, and so they took their passion as a god.
Mm-hmm.
Right? They worshiped
yes.
their passion.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Right? So it's not
yes.
just kind of like
yes.
this paganism that you can
yes.
pretend is a part of our life.
So there's a tangible god and intangible, your desires, your pain, and so on. Yes, you could take God, you know, you could worship money without knowing it actually, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so on. Yes, absolutely. So, and also in the book, God is very angry about this also, you know, anything, worshiping anything other than Him. So this is one. The second is, stories. And we have before stories, previous stories, hereafter. Hereafter is the second biggest subject in this book. There is an afterlife, there is a day of judgment, and there is an explicit full definition explanation, what is being, how it is, what is the end times, what will happen during the resurrection, during the day of judgment. It's quite interesting. It is more in the towards the end of the book, if you read it. So we believe that Muslims, everything we do, our conduct, action will be judged. So nobody can guarantee heaven just because of their good deeds, because there are multiple layers behind this. What was your intention? What was your motives? And then so on. So. People are quite, they worked really hard during their lifetime in the past because they feel the day of judgment. There's a strong belief in this for the hereafter. And in the hereafter, God is an only judge without partner. He's judging everybody one by one, including prophets. In fact, Jesus is being questioned. There is a one scene from that afterlife. God is asking him, "Did you tell you are the God?" And he's saying, "No." His answer is, "You know what I said and what I didn't say."
Mm-hmm.
He's not saying I did say or I didn't say it. So some of the wording is quite interesting, actually. You know, so we are studying. You know, we were. Well, so what's that mean? yes.
I know you mentioned it more than once, and I'm just thinking about, I'm not sure the Torah, but in the Bible there's a lot of different, even in the same language, so in English there's a lot of different versions, and maybe a pronoun might be different or a certain
yes.
descriptive. Does that happen a lot in the Quran?
So that's one of the...
At least like in English.
Yes, of course. So Quran is literally meaning recitation or reading.
Mm-hmm.
So Quran is only one language, which is Arabic. Anything other than Arabic translation, it is called translation of Quran. They don't call it Quran no more.
Mm-hmm.
So it is a translation of whomever translated this.
Mm-hmm.
So so far we have over 650,000 different translations
mm-hmm.
of this book. But the good part is they can refer to the source. So we can question and try to understand whether it's an accurate translation or not. Yes.
That's really quite different. I've never heard anything like that before. This should say
right.
the translation.
Right, yeah, this is the translation of Quran, yes. So because every translation you lose some of the, meaning. Yeah, some little by little. So that's why we kept it Arabic. So during the prayer, Arabic is being recited. Yes, sir.
It would seem to me that the Quran was made instructing peace amongst yourself and with other people.
Yes.
So the extremists that are out there, what are they seeing in the Quran that allows them to worship it? Same time as carry on all this stuff.
Yeah, John asked the similar question, right? During the breakfast. So he said, well, how come extremists can inspire from this book? So we have a problem right now, ISIS in the Middle East. I think ISIS is quite equivalent of KKK.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yes.
How much KKK is representing Christianity,
yeah.
ISIS is that much representing this group.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So Middle East, what's going on is over there, long story short, it's a chaos.
Mm-hmm.
There is no state, there is no order, so anything can come out from this mess. So hopefully soon enough we'll have some stable government there. So, you know, so you can take a verse, you can justify it to your whatever you are doing.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
but we do have, as a Muslims, 1,400 years of history where we live together with Christians and Muslims side by side. So long. In fact, Jewish, you know, they came from Spain into the Ottoman Empire to have a safe, you know, to have some safety. And so on. So we do have a history, and Muslim in the peak point empire never colonized anybody. For instance, Greek people, they live under the Muslim flag 600 years. Yet they still speak their own language, and they still have their own religion. So this book, because of this book, why? This book is prohibited to force anybody into religion. It's supposed to be by your free will,
choice.
Mm-hmm.
By your choice. Otherwise, it wouldn't be your faith. So it is strictly prohibited to anybody just even push. It is recommended to invite them, but it is because of that Muslims never, most of the time. Sometimes, yeah, during the fall, during that at the end of the empire, yes, there was some mess going on. But yes, not because of this book, because of the chaos again.
Yeah.
When there's a chaos, yeah.
So.
Is there sections of it that's apocalyptic? And is that something that ISIS would be more apt to do their fanaticism? That apocalyptic literature can be very, very far out, very.
Yeah.
Yes, of course. But honestly, I'm not an expert of ISIS. I tried to read some, but it's just too much. My understanding is they are referring more to the interpretations more than the verses. So they find some of the scholars, they like it, so they go by their interpretation more than the verses itself. So
I'm smiling over here.
Yes.
The surah that you read earlier, the verse right after we stopped. Indeed, man transgresses because he sees himself self-sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yes.
The acknowledgement of human brokenness,
yes,
that leads to all of this stuff,
yeah,
is right there.
Yes. Yes. True.
I was just wondering, we're spending a lot of time, and it's very important. But you said there were three main.
Yes, the third one is the stories. The third one is the previous generation stories. Page, let's read some.
Okay.
Page 217.
Tell us what surah it is.
215, surah 12, chapter 12. 215, chapter 12. Let's say, Matt, do you mind reading this?
Sure. Beginning at verse 1?
Yeah, why not?
These are the verses of the clear book.
No, 215. Page 215.
Yes.
Yeah.
The blue book?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yes. So, I'm sorry, I skipped the Elif Lam Mim, which means...
I'm chicken.
So this is interesting. This is the letters.
Letters.
God says letters. Okay, this is the Arabic letters. A, L, and R. And some of the chapters start like this. And the best interpretation that I like, God...